I'm going to preface this story by saying there are some pretty gross details, and there's no gross photographs. There's nothing gruesome in this video to look at, but you're going to hear some pretty gruesome details about what happened to John Eric Hexum. The story is about John Eric Hexum, an actor, an impossibly good-looking man, and his tragic death in 1984. But there are some details, so just be aware if you're squeamish, you know, by descriptions. You know, maybe this one's not for you. These are the facts about a historic figure, an actor named John Eric Hexum. John Eric Hexum was best known for a TV show called The Voyagers. This is a copy of a Playgirl magazine, which I got for the articles. But this is him on the cover of it. It's not a nude photo shoot. And he was, The Voyagers was his big show that he did. Actually, he did a movie called Making of a Male Model with Joan Collins. He went to college in Michigan State University, and he worked as a radio disc jockey. He was in athletics. He did diving. He did wrestling. He did football. He was a concert pianist. He earned a bachelor in philosophy. I mean, you know, the only thing I hadn't heard that he did was singing. I mean, every box was ticked. He had a great voice. He was a DJ. He excelled in all these sports, and it was obvious that most people wanted to talk about his looks. That's how people noticed him. And the shows he was on, he was always like without a shirt. He would stop people in their tracks. And he knew that, but he was pretty humble about it. He would say that his looks got him in the door, but he still, you know, had to come up with the goods to get parts. So after graduation, Hexum went to New York City to pursue acting. He did odd jobs here and there. He was a bartender at some, they say, sleazy bar in Times Square. And he did cleaning, too. And he was cleaning office. He was cleaning blinds, I say Venetian blinds, in some office in New York City. He was noticed by a man named Robert LeMond, who was a show business manager who represented John Travolta, and he saw the potential in John Eric Hexum, and he convinced him to quit New York and go to Los Angeles and try his hand at working, you know, in show business on television and in films. LeMond also represented Mark Harmon, Mickey Rourke, Patrick Swayze, and Katherine Helmond. So LeMond told him not to accept any offers. I mean, Hexum was broke. You know, he was a struggling actor, and he was getting offers for parts in shows like Dukes of Hazzard and Chips. But his agent said, no, don't do it. Don't accept any roles. And he found it difficult because he was broke. And he says people were offering him like 50 grand to appear in stuff, and he had to refuse it. After 4 months after being in Los Angeles, he was cast in the lead role in a show called Voyagers, which is about a time traveling pirate who would go back in time to make sure things happened the right way. As I understand it, I remember seeing a couple of episodes when it was out before Hexum died, and he was riveting. He was.
We travel through time to help history along. Give it a push where it's needed.
The Voyagers didn't last very long. They made 20 episodes, but it was put up against, I guess, the show 60 Minutes. And so 20 episodes of a show is significant to have completed, but it was still opposite the show 60 Minutes, which was a hugely popular sort of new show. And they never thought to move the series, I guess, and it was canceled after one season. It was 1983 that he got the part with Joan Collins in the Making of a Male Model. And later on, he said that it was trashy and exploitative, but then it was always going to be Making of a Male Model. I mean, it was shirts off and just lots of sexy guys. It was basically what they call it, male jiggle television, which was, you know, popular in the 70s for females. But there was, so he said it was quite gratuitous and he was embarrassed about it. But again, he knew that his looks got him in the door, but he still had to come up with the goods to be in shows.
It's Tyler Burnett.
Who sent you?
I'm from Dylan Models.
Take off your shirt. I want to see your body. Take it off. Could I give you some advice? Get yourself a hairstyling and do something about your eyebrows. I can't see your eyes.
See, what it all adds up to is a return of that good old American commodity known as lust. Only this time, it's turned around with the accent on you men.
Lust.
Mm-hmm. Low down, but high tone. Heated, but harmless. Lust.
Anyway, I found this Playgirl magazine, and this was interestingly published in November of 1984, and he died in October of 1984, so this was probably on the shelves at the time of Hexum's death, but look, I mean, just look at this guy. I mean, he was just, and to think that he was a nice guy, and he did all these, you know, nice roles, and he was all that talented, and he was an athlete and, you know, musician and all that business. It's crazy that he had that he was so successful, that he was such a well-rounded person. But in that article, I highlighted a couple of things that I found. So he says that, okay, so he, after the Voyagers was canceled, he says Hexum, this article says, he pumped $50,000 of his own money into a self-promotion plan that had him traveling around the country doing talk shows, cutting ribbons, and generally capitalizing on the fact that although his show was about to bite the dust, the reviews were so good, or the reviews were good, and so was he. And then 5 weeks later, he got that Making of a Male Model. Bob Lamond, the guy who he says used to guide John Travolta's career, called Hexum a 100%er. Attempting to describe the way he works with his clients, Lamond leaps to his feet and burst into frenzied bout of ya-ya shaking. You know, he says, when you're an Ike-ette behind Tina Turner, and you're up there shaking away, and she's up there shaking away, well, as long as she's in front shaking just as hard or even harder, you can't bitch. You just keep right on shaking. That's how it is. That's how it is with John Eric Hexum. So there's a definition that I'm still trying to figure out. And I've read this a couple of times. It mentions his workout plan, 30 minutes, bicycle ride for 30 minutes each morning, and works out at the gym alternate days, lifting free weights. He runs 30 to 45 minutes, maintaining a steady 190 pounds. When he's not working, he flings himself into daily acting classes, spicing up the menu with improv, cold readings, twice weekly voice classes, and twice weekly classes in contemporary jazz dance. Now, he graduated to Michigan State University studying biomedical engineering. I mean, really. And he was fascinated with the idea of making artificial hearts and kidneys. I just think that's kind of an interesting to point out, as you will hear about in a very short period of time. I'll get there, I promise. He switched to philosophy. He started reading Aristotle and Thoreau. I said, wow, this is heavy. This is hot. Wow, I'm an intellectual. Then after a while, I thought, I think this is bullshit. So he was funny too. A couple of other things. I do know that you're going to see, well, I'll show you now. He lived in a pretty modest home in Burbank, apparently. I think he owned it. I think he had roommates that were paying him rent, but I think he owned the house. But it was, you know, a nice, comfortable home in Burbank, not flashy. So it just shows that he was, you know, pretty decent guy, well-grounded. By all accounts, not just magazine articles, but a lot of people say that he was. When he was younger and he was in school, he says there was a schoolmate of his that was, her parents were going through a divorce, and he made sure that he sought her out every day and made her smile. And there was another girl that was a victim of bullying in school, and I guess confided in him, and he stood up for her when no one ever did. So he does, you know, he just seems like just decent guy. You know, he had finished completing a movie with Gary Busey called The Bear. And that was actually released in October of 1984. And he was cast in this show called Cover Up. He was playing a former Green Beret posing as a male model with lots of shirt off scenes, I'm sure. Doing undercover work with a fashion photographer portrayed by Jennifer O'Neill. And ironically, this former Green Beret was also, you know, to be a Green Beret, you have to be fairly well versed in handling weapons. So in real life, he should have portrayed that as well on the show. But as you'll hear in a second. So it was the morning of October 12th of 1984. The show was being filmed at 20th Century Fox in Culver City. They were filming on stage 17. And it was about 5:15 in the afternoon. They were in between scenes. Actor sitting around is mostly what actors do. If you got a 12-hour day, you're working for about an hour of it. And the other 11 hours, you're sitting around and waiting for the set dressers and the costumers and the hair people to take care of everything. And then you shoot, you know, and do three lines, and then you have to sit for another hour. And so it's pretty boring life. And when that day was at 5:15 in the afternoon, you know, they were pretty punchy for after being there so all along the whole day. So he was doing a scene in bed, probably without a shirt on, and there was a 44 Magnum that he was going to be using in the scene. And apparently this wasn't a prop gun. It was a real 44 Magnum. I don't know why that still seems today that they don't use prop guns. I understand that there's a realism effect of it, but it just seems like after all 40 years has gone since Johnny Eric Hexum has died, and this stuff is still happening. It's shocking to me that it's still happening that way. So John Eric Hexum's playing with this weapon. It's a revolver, so he's spinning the barrel, and they say he's unloading it, according to some of the crew that were working on the movie, unloading it and loading it again, and just messing around with it. And now it had blanks in it, supposedly. Well, it did have blanks in it. And I guess he didn't know that there are, even though they're blanks, something comes out of those blanks, because there's a realism, you know, that has to, you know, the gunpowder has to ignite, and something comes out of it for the realism, for the effect of it, for, you know, for the film. So something did come out, but I don't think he knew that. In fact, I think it's well established that John Eric Hexum did not know that things came out of blanks. They did no schooling on the set. No, they call them armorers now. We know that because of the Helena Hutchins, Alec Baldwin thing. So there's somebody supposed to be that's a weapons expert. And back then, 40 years ago, they probably went, here's a 44, you know, oh, be careful with it. You know, it's just boggling. So, but it was not a prop gun. It was a real gun. Hexum was messing around with it. He puts the 44 up to the right side of his head. His last words were, let's see if, after he's spinning it, you know, this was accidentally spinning the barrel, you know, loading and unloading the blanks, puts it up to his head, and he says, let's see if I got one for me. That was the last thing he ever said. There was a loud bang, a giant flash, and a puff of black smoke. When they looked to see him, because a lot of people just weren't paying attention, they saw him writhing on the bed. He had fallen backwards, and blood was streaming from this head wound. One of his assistants ran to him with a towel and wrapped it around his head to attempt to stop the bleeding. And but it was clearly a really, really bad injury. He was at that point still screaming and writhing. It wasn't, you know, shortly, a very, very short period of time that had it stopped. But the ambulance was called, but the crew didn't want to wait, because the Beverly Hills Medical Center, which is now a Marriott hotel, is less than a mile from 20th Century Fox Studios. So they figure, why should we wait? Let's just put him in the back of one of these studio vehicles and take him directly to the hospital. So that's what they did. And it's Beverly Hills Medical Center now. So John Eric Hexum was making a show here called Cover Up. And he was working with a 44 caliber revolver, and he didn't know that blanks actually shoot things. He just figured blanks were blanks. And he was bored filming
lighten it up. He took the gun with three dummy rounds and two blank cartridges, spun it around and put it up to his temple. And he was taken to what was the Beverly Hills Medical Center, which is now actually a hotel. So this is the route. And you'll see it coming up on the left. It's a curved building. And people don't realize that it actually was a hospital at one point in time. Beyond this white hotel. But he went into a coma. And well, they took him to the hospital, and he had a craniotomy for an elevation of depressed skull fracture and to remove bone fragments from a large entry wound. There it is up on the left. It's the Residence Inn. This bus is in our way, but that is the old hospital where he was taken. And it said he never regained consciousness. And October 18th of 1984, this building on the left, this hotel. Can we make a left here? That'd be great. Okay, so now we're on the exterior of what is now the Marriott. Now it was a hospital. So this is where John Eric Hexum was taken.
Now, John Eric Hexum was in surgery for 5 hours. His situation remained critical, but after 6 days in a coma, he survived. He was alive, and he was kept alive, actually on respirators, and for 6 days. And I believe during that 6 days, they knew he wasn't getting out. You know, he wasn't coming out of the hospital. There was no activity, brain activity, and I believe they were just setting the groundwork to have for organ donation. So 6 days passed, and they finally, they didn't even pull the plug. The accident happened on the 12th of October. On the 18th of October, he was officially pronounced dead. Now, brain dead, but dead. So he was dead, but he was still kept alive. His body was still, you know, they're keeping the blood circulated, to maintain his organs. His heart and his kidneys and his lungs and everything were still, you know, they were mechanically, being operated, you know, with respirators and things like that. But interesting to note, his girlfriend at the time, I don't know how long they were dating, was actress E.G. Daly, who you might remember. I like her best from, she was in Pee-wee's Big Adventure. I love the movie One Dark Night. It was a horror movie that she was in. And she was the voice of Tommy Pickles in the Rugrat movies, or the Rugrat TV shows. And she was his girlfriend at the time. And I saw a one-woman show of hers in L.A. several years ago, and she recounts in great detail of those days where the family and she and friends were gathered at this Beverly Hills Medical Center just waiting to, you know, for something to happen. They officially pronounced him dead on the 18th, 6 days after the accident. And with his mother's permission, John Eric Hexum, still on life support, was flown up to San Francisco. And while there, his body was used to help other people in critical condition across the country. So they call it organ harvesting. And so I just think this is an unusual term, but it makes complete sense. But it's such a harvesting. It just seems like what I would say organ donations or something like that. But that's basically what it is. I just personally thought that harvesting was kind of an odd term to use for it. But that is the official term. So up in San Francisco, his organs were harvested. And then John Eric Hexum was brought back down to Los Angeles. Now, what I'm going to read for you now, well, this is his death certificate. This is his death certificate dated the 18th of October, 1984. And it says gunshot wound to head, accidental discharge of a firearm. So what I will do is I will put this document on the screen so you can see it clearly. And it has his address and his place of death, which is the Beverly Hills Medical Center. The accident occurred on a movie studio. He was cremated. Well, I'll get to that one. He was cremated on Halloween, October 31st of 1984. So the autopsy report. Now, I'm going to read some of these. This is, it's so confusing. The accident on the 12th, pronounced dead on the 18th, autopsy on the 20th, and then another autopsy on his brain on November 7th. So there's all, it's kind of a jumpy sort of thing. But on this one, the synopsis of this whole incident, and it's dated the 20th. So it's a jump around. The accident occurred on the 12th. The decedent is a male, 26 years old, who shot himself in the head with a prop handgun. It was a real gun at a movie studio. The handgun had blanks in it. The decedent was transported to the hospital where surgery was performed and then placed on a life support system. He was pronounced brain dead at the hospital. No note was found. So I imagine that means it wasn't something he had pre-planned. The investigation. According to police records, the decedent is employed as an actor, 20th Century Fox, on Pico Boulevard in West Los Angeles. At about 5:10 p.m., he was in the company of three other employees at the studio, and the decedent was in between takes and picked up a .44 caliber 2-inch Magnaport revolver. The decedent loaded three dummy rounds and two live blank cartridges into the revolver. The decedent then spun the cylinder and placed the revolver to his right side of his head, stating, "Let's see if I got myself with this one." There's going to be some repetition in here just because these are the documents and it is repeated quite a bit. The decedent pulled the trigger. The revolver fired, causing a gunshot blast to the right temple. The decedent was transported by two fellow employees to the Beverly Hills Medical Center just down the street. Temporal cranial surgery was performed on the decedent, then was placed on life support. He was pronounced dead at 5:30 p.m. on the 18th by Dr. Ditsworth. Permission was obtained from the family for multiple organ transplant donation. This is going to be really interesting because I want you to know, I'm going to tell you who the recipients were of John Eric Hexum's body parts, the donation. He was maintained on a respirator and was transferred by airplane to the Pacific Presbyterian Medical Center in San Francisco. His heart, corneas, and kidneys were harvested at the medical center for transplantation. He was transferred by Packard Transport Service to the Forensic Science Center. After arriving in Los Angeles, the decedent's skin was harvested. I've seen them doing that in mortuaries, and it's, well, I'm pretty squeamish, and just the story is a little bit squeamish, but I've seen them doing that, and it's pretty, well, it's graphic. It just is graphic. It's not for the weak of stomach to see them doing something like that, but it helped people. It helped people, as you'll hear in just a moment. This investigator says, "I observed the decedent nude on the transfer table. He had a tube in his mouth. IVs were noted in each arm. A sutured surgical incision was noted on the right side of his head. A midline sutured surgical incision was noted on his chest and abdomen. Identification was made by a toe tag. External examination. The hair on the scalp has been shaved but appears brown. The irises are not evident because both eyes were removed, so his eyes were donated. The teeth are in good repair and mouth is otherwise not unusual. The external auditory canals are not unusual, his ears. The neck is supple with the trachea in the midline. The chest is symmetrical. Blah, blah, blah. The abdomen is flat. The external genitalia are not unusual. The posterior surface of the body shows no evidence of trauma." Now, this is the evidence in the autopsy report after he was brought back, after the skin was removed, actually. So this is the evidence of postmortem organ harvesting. Multiple donor sites are found at the interior and posterior torso, right and left upper extremities, anterior and posterior thighs, and anterior and posterior lower extremities. The left and right eyes have been removed from the sockets. Organ harvesting through the thorax and abdomen performed through a thoracoabdominal sternal splitting incision from the manubrium. I'm going to stop doing this. The heart has been removed, as well as the left and right kidneys and a small portion of the spleen. Cardiovascular system. The heart is removed for postmortem donation. The aorta, pulmonary artery, and great veins arise normally and follow the usual courses. The tongue, upper pharynx, larynx, trachea, and bronchi are all contained in a small amount of pink mucus. The larynx, hyoid, and trachea are not unusual. specimens. Samples of all the organs are preserved in 10% formaldehyde and placed in a storage container. Skin from the gunshot entrance wound and right temple are placed in a cassette and submitted to histopathology. Skin from the gunshot entrance wound and right temple are placed in a cassette and submitted. And it says photographs were taken. There was a rumor that those photographs, well, they do exist somewhere, but they're not around. Someone asked me if they're out available online, but, or, you know, if you could see them, but I've never seen them, so I don't think so. But they were certainly taken, and they're in storage at the LA County Coroner. These photographs are probably all on slides now, but, well, actually 40 years ago, they might probably still be photographs there, physical photographs. Now, his brain was removed, okay? And on November 7th, this is how many, almost a month after the accident, it's going into the circumstances again, but they had to do this over again because the brain, you know, the autopsy on the body and now the autopsy on the brain. It says he was an actor, 3 dummy rounds, 2 live blank cartridges, spun the cylinder, placed the revolver, transported. Let's see, at admission, the patient was in a coma and with fixed dilated pupils and minimal corneal responses were present. So they did the light, you know, to make sure there was to see if there was a reaction with light to the eyes. Minimal corneal responses were present, and there was no response to deep pain. Post-operatively, he showed no signs of brain activity, and subsequent EEGs were flat. He became the subject of organ donations. Gross findings are photographed. Selected areas are retained in storage as evidence. Final neuropathological diagnosis: acute cerebral trauma, gunshot wound to brain, right anterior temporal lobe, and posterior orbital frontal lobe. 44 caliber live blank cartridges. So what I'm going to do is I will be inserting certain photographs in here of, or these images of his autopsy report, and you can see the damage to his brain there on the bottom. And this is after he got back, so you can see that there was life support, you know, there was a life support tube and yeah, these are life support tubes that were inserted, and evidence of IVs, more brain damage. My friend Craig Harvey, who is retired of the LA County Coroner, he was the chief of special investigations. I'm so fortunate to be able to reach out to Craig and ask him specifically about these things and how they're interpreted, because I didn't really understand the dates. You know, how could he accident? They knew he was dead, brain dead at the time, but he was pronounced dead 6 days later, then sent to San Francisco, then brought back down and autopsied, and then his brain autopsied again. So it was almost like a month-long issue. Now, about the brain itself, he says, Craig told me the neuropathology report, or the brain of the examination, that Dr. Itabashi was a consultant, not full-time staff. He did not come to the office every day. As a result, the cases he was assigned were often held and batched, with multiple cases completed at one sitting. Suffice to say, the brain was recovered by the deputy medical examiner at the time of the autopsy and placed in a fixing solution, formalin, until Dr. Itabashi was prepared to do the examination. The brains require, I found this fascinating, they're called fixing, which is a firming up before they can be cut and studied. So once the brain study is completed, most, if not all, the tissue would be disposed of, except for microscopic slides, which they probably kept. Now, John Eric Hexum was cremated at Grandview Cemetery and Crematorium in Glendale, California. And if you saw that, that's a cemetery that's gone through several years of financial troubles. But the crematory is still there, and the crematory is operational. And I know that, like, Rock Hudson was cremated there, and I think Wayland Flowers and John Eric Hexum. His ashes were scattered over Malibu with his mother, or by his mother. Now, they say that the film The Bear that he had completed with Gary Busey was on the screens at the time and pulled from the screens, although it's more likely that the movie wasn't very good because you haven't heard of it. And I'm saying that as a fact. I don't know that, but it wasn't a very good movie. And the Playgirl date, you know, on that mat in the magazine was November of 1984. Just kind of interesting. It was probably on the stands when John Erik died. And 20th Century Fox decided to continue on making the show cover up with a new actor, but that didn't last for very long. Now, I mentioned the organ donation, and this is a letter. My friend Casey Connolly, by the way, I have to thank her for all the help with the research in this. She was able to clarify a lot of things that I've heard over the years about John Erik Hexham, and she was able to, you know, as I said, clear it up if they were fact or fiction. And when I asked about things like the organs and what happened to them, she was able to find this document and share it with me. It's from the Northern California Transplant Bank. And it says, "Dear Mrs. Hexham, on behalf of the entire transplant community, I wish to extend our condolences to you upon the tragic loss of your son, John Erik. We also are extremely grateful to you and your son, Gunnar," that was John Erik's brother, "for considering others during this very sad time. Your incredible gift has touched the lives of many, many individuals. As a result of your kindness and generosity, a 37-year-old man successfully received a heart transplant. One of the kidney recipients was a 5-year-old boy who was also critically ill. Physicians estimated that he would only have a few months more of life remaining if he continued to require the support of the artificial kidney machine. The other recipient was a 43-year-old woman, mother to three, and grandmother to three. This lady had waited 8 years for a kidney that was closely matched as your son's kidney was. Both corneas were also successfully transplanted. One cornea was used for a patient with an injury that required immediate transplantation. Had a cornea not been available, this patient would have lost entire sight in that eye. The other recipient had waited 4 months for the opportunity to regain his vision. Finally, skin that was donated was used today to treat a 3.5-year-old boy with third-degree burns. Through this gesture you and your family have made, several lives were saved while other patients were restored to a normal life. Although nothing can mitigate the tragedy of your son's death, your gift of life and sight will encourage many families to also think of donation. We only hope that this legacy of humanitarianism will comfort you during this difficult time. Please don't hesitate to contact us if we may be of any assistance." That's from the program director of the Northern California Transplant Bank. What I'm going to tell you now, I found the most fascinating and sad, really. The heart, John Erik Hexham's heart, was donated, said, to a 37-year-old man. His name was Michael Washington, who lived in Las Vegas. He owned an escort business called the Swinging Susies. And his criminal record was insane. I mean, crime after crime after crime after crime. Pimping and pandering. There's one that was called Unlawful Agree to Division of Salary, which I can only imagine that he had escorts working for him, that he was taking their money and not paying them. He was using stolen credit cards. And I happened to have the opportunity to talk to one of the women who worked for him, who was a sex worker, and said that he was one of the most foul people. She and someone else were talking and said that they doubted that a heart like that had that much hate in it before it beat in Michael's chest, Michael Washington. Michael Washington, she said, threatened to kill them or any of his workers at the drop of a hat. He himself said at the time, when he got some flack for you know, finding out that he owned a ranch, and he said that the Hexham family really didn't care about all of that. What they cared about was giving an organ to help a family or seeing someone survive. It gave an opportunity for my two kids to still have a father, which is the case. Anyway, he died in 2002 in Las Vegas. So because of John Erik Hexham, this gentleman was able to survive for another 18 years. So to summarize, John Erik Hexham's dead 40 years now. His memory has sort of faded with people. There were a lot of fan pages on the internet devoted to him at the time, and those have all sort of dwindled. And a memorial, they were going to have a public memorial for him, and they were going to try, there's no grave. His ashes were scattered over Malibu, and there was no place for fans to actually go and pay their respects to John Eric Hexum. So my friend Casey Conley took up the task, and she contacted Valhalla Memorial Park in North Hollywood. Now, that may sound familiar to you guys coming from me, because, you know, we work with them quite closely several times, marking graves like, you know, Mishu and Pugsley, Ken Weatherwax and Johnny Arthur. And we worked with Valhalla a lot, and they're very nice people and very willing to work with people. And Casey Conley ended up being able to purchase a niche for John Eric Hexum, or a space. There's a memorial wall. Actually, the video is probably taking you through it now. And there's a plaque for John Eric Hexum there. So now fans have a place to go.
Hi guys, Casey here. I thought I'd come down to Valhalla and film, since you guys weren't able to make it to see the memorial. I kind of wanted to show you where it was and how it all looks. It turned out really beautiful. As you can see, there are some important markers where we're at. Over on this side, when it's warmer weather and we don't have a drought, the fountains are going, but it's kind of a neat little zen garden all through there, and the neat palm trees. Now Jack's memorial is just right over here, just a small walk. And here it is, top row center. Prominent place where he should be. Somebody already visited and left a little rock for him, so somebody's already seen where our boy is. Beautiful little atrium here. Neat little bench to pay respects at. Down below. And if you can come with me just a little bit. Kind of hard to see, but just right over through the trees and things is where Jack lived.
You know, he seemed like a really quality individual. He was known as being humble. As I mentioned, those stories about when he was young and helping out his friends when he was young, and just being a kind guy, hugely talented, hugely good looking, you know, sports, into sports and music and everything, and philosophy. He like ticked all the boxes, and it seems like, it seems like a real waste. And but then his gift of life for other people, I think that that's just, if there's any other thing, because John Eric Hexum sort of faded from a lot of people's memories, other people are alive. Other people can see. Other people have, you know, unscarred skin because of John Eric Hexum. So I think it's an awesome way to be remembered, you know, not even necessarily just to be remembered. You gave life, and you can remember him too at Valhalla Memorial Park, thanks to Casey Collins. And I have to shout out to my friend Roger Sinclair as well, who provided a lot of the information that I got from about John Eric Hexum as well, the late great Roger Sinclair. Now, there was a lawsuit. 20th Century Fox was sued by John Eric Hexum's mother for neglect, for, you know, not being, making it a safe set. It's fascinating, again, 40 years ago, and these things are still happening. I mean, the Helena Hutchins thing, the similarities, although the weapon was not in anyone else's hands in John Eric Hexum's place, it's still a live weapon on a movie set. And in the Helena Hutchins case, there was an armorer. Her sole job was to deal with the weapons, but that was not the case with John Eric Hexum. They just gave him a gun and said, here, and he was just monkeying around. So it's quite sad, but she did sue Fox, and there was a out of court settlement. So, yeah. So I guess, you know, there was another story. It says that when he was bartending in New York, after work, he would walk one of his employees back to her car to make sure she made it safely. I think that's classy. So rest in peace, John Eric Hexum. He seemed like a decent guy. And thank you guys so much for watching. I appreciate your time. I appreciate your attention. And until next time.
You heard me.